السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما، وألحقنا بعبادك الصالحين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Last time we spoke about after the battle of Strange. We finished, yes. And Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم started to take revenge from those who participated in the battle of Strange against Muslims and wanted to eliminate Muslims. So, yes. Yes. So one of those tribes, Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم sent Sariya, we call it Sariya. And he himself wanted to participate. That's why there is big difference between Sariya and Ghazwa. Why? If Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم didn't participate, we call it Sariya. If he participates, even if the number of the soldiers are less, we call it Ghazwa. Yes. So in this one, it was Ghazwa. Why? Because he himself, صلى الله عليه وسلم, participated. So he knows that that tribe waiting for his revenge from the beginning. Why? They are the tribe who involved in the killing of the ulama of Sahaba when Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم sent the Sahaba to teach them. They are those people who killed them. So we have one time they killed 40 Sahaba, and another time killed 6. Those people who killed 6. So it was like they are waiting from all that time. Even though that incident happened before the Battle of Trench, but they're still waiting for revenge. They know that Sayyidina Muhammad will punish them. So Sayyidina Muhammad, because he knows that they are aware and they are ready and they are waiting, he wanted to like make good strategy in the war to make them feel that he never come to them. So he can take them at once. So they are in the like north, south. They are in the south. Sayyidina Muhammad took his army and went to north. So everyone thought that he is going to another place, like it's north. And not only that, he went to north 20 miles, like walked for a long time. Then after 20 miles, everyone spoke that Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam went to another place, so don't worry, everything is okay. After 20 miles, he turned back and went to them. But subhanAllah, the like expected. That's why they run away before even Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم go to the place. He arrived to their tribe, no one there. All of them left the tribe, all of them run. Then Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم stayed there 3 days in that tribe. And then he sent Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq رضي الله عنه and another 9 Sahabi, so they are 10. All of them have horses, so they are knights. Where? To Mecca. Why? He wants to put in the mind of everyone that Muslims are not weak anymore and don't even try to think to mess up with Muslims. Finish. That time is finished. So he finished that tribe, they ran away. He sent 10 knights from that tribe until Mecca. Why? To spread the news that Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam conquered Mecca. Also, it's not for war, of course, 10 knights can't do anything, but just for news. That's why I said now media is the strongest weapon in the world now. Media. News. Can change everything. That's what Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam worked on that point at that time. From 1,400 years ago, he worked on that point. Spread the news that we are powerful, that no one now can change us by 10 nights. And subhanAllah, success. 10 nights went like near to Mecca. Everyone heard about that. That's like news spread in everywhere. Then they went back safe, no one of them alhamdulillah injured or killed, and they went back to the Medina. This is the first point about that tribe. Then again, another tribe wanted to eliminate Muslims in Medina. Who are they? Bani Ghadafan. They are very strong tribe, not normal people. You are speaking about at least 10,000 person from one tribe. 10,000 person. So Bani Ghadafan started to like prepare their arms, started to like collect their weapons and put the plan, and they said, we will conquer Medina, we will finish Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, we will finish the Muslims and Islam will finish. Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم heard like about that they are collecting army. They changed their mind and not sent army. They sent like one unit and they said, okay, we will not conquer Medina, we will conquer the fields, the agricultural places of Medina outside. So no one of Muslims' army will be ready. They will know that we are not coming for war. No one of the Muslims know about that. The son of the leader of Bani Ghadafan, the son of his of the leader, and he took one unit and went to the border of Medina. So the field and agricultural districts. Who was there? The son of Sayyidina Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu. His son and his wife. Not the wife of Sayyidina Abu Dharr, the son and the wife of the son. They were there, working in their place. They saw them, they killed the son of Sayyidina Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu. So he became shaheed. And they took his wife. And they took all the camels which eating the grass and these things at that place. And included the camel of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was also there. So they killed one Sahabi, the son of Sayyidina Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu. Radiallahu anhu, of course, and because he's Sahabi and his father Sahabi. And they took his wife and they took the camels and they went back to Bani Ghadafan. Of course, Bani Ghadafan is not a small tribe, it's very big. Their way when they are going back to Bani Ghadafan, the people who were taking care of agriculture, they saw what happened. Someone went back very fast to the direction of Medina to tell the people about what happened from those people. One Sahabi, his name Salama ibn al-Aqwa. He is very famous. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best warrior who fight on his leg, on his legs, Sayyidina Salama ibn al-Aqwa. The best, no one better than him. Yes, his speed faster than horse. His real speed faster than horse. Subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put that power in him. His speed faster than horse. You can imagine how it is. Then they told him, he was like riding his camel. He went back from his camel. He gives the camel to the person and he told him, go to Medina and tell Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and tell the people to come. He from there, from the point, run to after the army, alone. What kind of braveness, what kind of power, what kind of speed, you can't imagine. And not that only, he reached and he catch the army, alone. He reached the army. Then he was having like bow and arrows and his sword. So what he want now, his strategy, he can't fight alone. Of course, he's one person and they are one unit. He will finish him in 1 second. So he said, like he in his mind, he depend on his speed and the same time to make them stop, to not go forward to Bani Ghadafan. He want to stop them to like let the unit of Muslim come and punish them. So when he saw them, he took his arrow and his bow and hit one. Of course, they stop all of them and say, who, that person, go and kill him. They went towards to him. When they became close to him, he ran. He's very fast, no one can catch him. Then they are searching for him, they can't find him. Then again, they went back to the like way of Bani Ghadafan. He came back to them, hit one. Who is he? The same person, come, kill him. Going close to him, they can't catch him, he run away. Of course not run away because he's scared. A'udhu billah, he's a sahabi, he's a brave person. It's strategy. We call it al-kar wal-far. الكر والفر. And subhanallah, Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, when the Sahabi came to him to tell him, Ya Rasulullah, the son of Sayyidina Abu Zar al-Ghifari has been killed, his wife has been kidnapped, the camels, all of the camels has been like stolen. Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم like called everyone for the like taking revenge from those people, but he divided them to two. First group, small group of knights who have horse only, he tells them immediately go after Sayyidina Sa'd ibn al-Aqwa, support him now. And Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم prepared 700 Sahabi. Because it's Bani Ghadafan, it's not game, it's not easy. So he prepared the army and he went towards to Bani Ghadafan, and the knights became the first, like went first to support Sayyidina Sa'd ibn al-Aqwa. While Sayyidina Sa'd ibn al-Aqwa was hitting them by bow and run, they come after him, they stop, they go back, like that kind of strategy, they lost their time until the knights came. When the knights came, the son of the leader of Bani Ghadafan understood what will happen. He told the unit, go back to Bani Ghadafan fast. And he only took three people. So he and another three people only stayed to fight Sayyidina Sa'd ibn al-Aqwa and left all the army, go back to Bani Ghadafan. The knights of Muslims came also. So now we have a group of Muslims. They are much bigger than those four kuffar. One Muslim didn't wait, he just went directly towards those four people, they killed him. Because like one against four, they finished him. Then the Sahaba, who are knights, have horses, went towards those four people, they killed the second son of the leader of the tribe. There were two sons, one is the leader, one is the leader of the unit, and his brother. They killed his brother. When they saw that, they scared too much, they left to Bani Ghadafan directly, run away. Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم came by his 700 soldier, and then they wanted to go towards to Bani Ghadafan. But like the way they wanted to do that, only to punish that unit, because they can't face Bani Ghadafan face to face. They are 10,000. How 10,000 against 700, but not only 700, they are not well prepared. Just everyone have his sword and just go. Like calling, now come for jihad, now. It's not like preparing for 10 days or no, just now come. So they are not well prepared. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم finally, when he like got confirmed that those people run away and there's no way to catch them, he gives order to Sahaba, go back. So this is also a good way to save the Muslim army, not just to, we will go, we will fight. No, not like that. Everything by plan, everything by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَعِدُّ لَهُمَّ اسْتَطَعْتُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ. So not only like have some ambition, like, let's go. Not like that. Everything by plan. And talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then this is the second thing happened. Then we have another tribe, their name is Bani Thalaba. Bani Thalaba also wanted to attack Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Bani Ghadafan and Bani Thalaba. Bani Thalaba also is a strong tribe. And he gathered the army to attack Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, of course, during Seerah, we understand that the strategy of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, when some army want to attack him, he don't wait for them, he go first for them. Don't wait. He go first for them. When he just confirmed that army willing to attack Medina, he don't wait for them. He go by himself until he reached the tribe. So Bani Thalaba, what the thing happened, it's actually a sad thing happened. Why? Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم chosen 10 people to go just explore the place, see how many people, what they are doing, what kind of weapons they have, like this. So Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Maslama was the leader. Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Maslama is very, very strong warrior, not normal person, very strong warrior. So Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم chosen 10 knights, all of them had horses, and told them go to Bani Thalaba, not to conquer them, just watch what they are doing, to prepare the army and come directly with real plan. During their way, when they are going to Bani Thalaba, Bani Thalaba were very, very, very smart. SubhanAllah, even by their name, Thalaba, Thalaba, folks. SubhanAllah, they are very smart. They had spy in every checkpoint, like they have points in every place, they have spy. So the Muslim army, the 10 people, they didn't expect that they had like that kind of spy. They thought that when they get closer to Bani Thalaba, they should take care, but not from the beginning. But the middle of the road, they had already spies. That's why they saw them. And then they told the Bani Thalaba, they brought army and came and finished the 10 Muslim, except Sayyidina Muhammad bin Salman. They injured him, then they thought he died. But as I told you, he is very, very strong warrior. Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Maslamah, not normal person, very strong warrior. So 10 Sahaba has been killed, except Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Maslamah was wounded and lying on the ground. They thought he died. Then they left. Then they went to check the 10 Sahaba, is someone still alive or not, and they hit them by their legs like this. And they also hit, alaykum as-salam, they also hit Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Salman, but he didn't move. He closed his eye like this, and he didn't move. So they confirmed that 10 of them has been killed. They left. So, subhanAllah, later, after like long time, one Muslim person like walked through this place. He saw 10 people died. He says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. When he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Salman heard him. And he knows that the person who said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, is Muslim. He's a Muslim. Then Sayyidina Muhammad ibn Salman said, I'm still alive. He spoke to that Muslim. Then he took him and he took care of him and gave him like stop his bleeding and these things. And he took him to Medina. Sayyidina Muhammad, when he heard about what happened, he sent big unit. And the leader was Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah. Mm-hmm. So Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah gives him, you know, huge listen. He went there, and when they just heard about his name, they ran away. And Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu captured one person from them, because he's the only person who stayed there. And he took all of their camels and sheep and everything. And then went back to Medina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him huge victory. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah. Then after that, this we are speaking about the 5th year after Hijrah. So the Battle of Trench and all these accidents happened in the 5th year. Now going to year number 6. Year number 6, we speak about Bani Mustalik. And Bani Mustalik is a very famous tribe also, and a very big tribe as well. Bani Mustalik also, same mentality. They want also to go and attack Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You don't know what's wrong with these people. You don't know. Yeah, Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Medina, giving dawah to everyone. Other tribes, putting in their mind, they want to finish Islam and Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You don't know what's wrong with these people. So don't get sad now if you see some people from outside attacking Islam. Don't get sad. It's from the first prophet. Not from Sayyidina Muhammad, from the first prophet, the enemies of Islam attacking Islam. It's like something in human beings. So just like have sabr and continue your way. Don't care about this, say like this and this. Just continue your way. Because enemies will never finish. The people who hate Islam will never finish. The people who hate dawah will never finish. Will never finish. So just do whatever you can. Shaitan, wallahi, Shaykh Shaitan, subhanAllah. Wallahi, subhanAllah, big shaitan, wallahi, subhanAllah. If you speak about us, we are very weak people, but Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he got huge enemies. Sayyidina Muhammad, the best creation, and he got huge enemies. What about us? We will have huge enemies, of course. So Bani Mustalik, he was tried. And they want also to attack Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم knew about what they want, same strategy. He said, no, I'm not waiting. Go for them. He went, he prepared very strong army action. And then he went to Banu Mustalib. And they are huge people, like not one or two, they are thousands of people. They know that Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم are coming also for them. Then they gathered the army and they met in some place. So he didn't reach their tribe, no. They went out and Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in the middle of the road, they met army to army. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا يَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرَ Allah subhanahu will give victory to who are like working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This promise from Allah. Like, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said to them, say لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله and you will become our brother in Islam and do no need for any war or anything. We will forgive you about even your betray and about the war or everything. Just say لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. You say no, لا إله إلا الله, we don't say anything. We will fight you, we will kill you, we will finish you. War started, and listen to this. Big enemy, big army against Muslims, and our number also not very huge. The ulama said the battle only took a few minutes. What happened? In a few minutes, Muslim army killed 10 of their masters. And their banner fall down. And when I mentioned Battle of Uhud, when the banner fall down, battle is finished. Because people at that time, when their banner is raised up like this, they have courage and our banner is like this. When the banner fall down, finish. So in the first minutes, few minutes in the battle, Sahaba radiallahu anhum killed 10, not 10 normal people, 10 masters of the Banu Mustalik. And the banner fall down, everyone got shocked and they give up. They lit, like lit their weapon, they drop their weapon and we give up. We give up. Like whatever you decide, we agree. Just we give up. Please let us. We give up. Like this. A few minutes. So it's not about the number. It's not about the power. It's about who have support from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who deserves support. Not only what. Who deserves the support from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And who is really working for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who is not? It's a huge thing. Not anyone can do it like that. To take support from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a huge thing. So who is the person who deserves support from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a big issue. Not easy. So they give up. And then of course their women and everything has been taken. Everything. Then now they came as a captive in Medina, and now Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم will decide about them. They wanted to eliminate Muslims and Sayyidina Muhammad and finish Medina. But now they are in the hand of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. From the like captive people, Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم got one woman, her name is Juwayriya, Sayyida Juwayriya. He saw her like very wise woman and like, you know, honest and high rank. He offered Islam for her. She accepted, she took shahada. He got married with her. So that's why you call Umm al-Mu'mineen Juwayriya, Sayyida Juwayriya. But as I told you before, even in our intensive course, I said after the marriage of Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha and after she died, every marriage became by the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa Not random, not because it's just a woman, no. Everyone for a purpose and order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you will understand why Sayyidina Muhammad sallam got married with Sayyida Juwayriya. When Sayyidina Muhammad sallam got married with her, and everyone knows about that, everyone who got another woman, he said, no. Now they are the family of Sayyidina Muhammad sallam. We must respect Sayyidina Muhammad sallam religion. And they release the women. And they give them back their money. Everything. And the people are watching. And they are watching the akhlaq of Muslimin. People are watching the akhlaq of Muslimin. Those people wanted to eliminate Islam and Muslims. And when Muslims like won the war, they didn't eliminate them. They didn't eliminate them. So it's not our issue to fight and kill people. A'udhu billah. It's not our issue to just kill anyone. And like, no. Our issue is to open the heart of the people for Islam. It's our issue. And everyone can decide to be Muslim or not if one has his own choice. So this is akhlaq of Islam. This is akhlaq of Islam, akhlaq of Muslimin. When Sayyidina Muhammad got married with Sayyidina Juwayriyah, Umm al-Mu'mineen, the people said, we can't like take any other woman, we can't even do anything for this man. Those became a family of Sayyidina Muhammad. So for respecting Sayyidina Muhammad, there is all of them. That's why the other like Ummah al-Mu'mineen, you know like some jealousy woman or woman like some jealousy, but they say, Subhanallah, the most woman who got like very big benefit for her people, as Sayyidina Juwayriyah. She saved the whole tribe only because she accepted Islam. But they ask her, why you accept Islam very fast like that? Like just Sayyidina Muhammad spoke to you, you just accept Islam like directly like that. She said, before the war, 3 days before the war, I saw a dream that the moon, Al-Badr, came from Medina and went to the heaven and then came to my heart, my chest. So she understood that is Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he will give her da'wah for Islam. And so that's what happened in after the war directly. And that's why she accepted Islam. Because she, before, she was interested about Islam. Not like, don't know, she interested about Islam. But maybe she wanted some chance. And she found it when Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke to her. That's about Banu Mustalik. And of course, you know what happened to Banu Mustalik later about the verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ. This also revealed for that incident, not after that incident. Like, they should pay zakah. I mentioned that khutbah maybe 3 weeks, 3 months ago. And Sheikh Ahmed in the last khutbah also mentioned this issue. So I don't need to repeat, just I think you use the same tribe as Banu Mustalik. The verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. This is about Banu Mustalik. Then one caravan from Quraysh, the news came to the Muslims that they are passing away near of Medina from the road. Sayyidina Muhammad gave order to Sayyidina Zayd to take unit and go and hide in a place. That place are full of caves and trees. Very, you know, like very difficult to walk by your army or by caravan. It's very difficult. So, and at the same time, very easy to hide there. Because you know, natural place, caves and trees and very nice place. So they saw the caravan of Quraysh. They attacked them and they took everything. Money and the people, they captured all of them and they went back to Medina. Among those people who has been captured, Al-Asr, who is that person? The husband of Sayyida Zainab. Sayyida Zainab who? The daughter of Sayyida Muhammad. But you will ask me now how? Like, he is kafir and she is Muslim. At that time, still not like revealed that it's not allowed to become with, you know, like to become separate if the husband is kafir or Muslim. Second, they were not living together. He was in Mecca and Sayyidina Muhammad took his daughter in Medina. So they are separate already. They are separate already. But still, her husband. So they captured all of them. They took them to Medina, they took the money, they took everything and went to the Medina. Mostly when they capture people, they put them in front of the like Masjid al-Nabawi or inside if they want to give da'wah or whatever, like maybe inside, maybe outside. So they took them and the husband of Sayyida Zainab also, radiallahu anha, was one of them. And then when Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it was a time of fajr, so they want to pray. When he says Allahu Akbar, he heard some voice from some woman. She said, "Ajartu al-Asr." He continues his prayer. He can't cut his prayer. Then he continues prayer. Then he like look who is talking. He found his daughter, Sayyida Zainab, radiallahu anha. Then he look at Sahaba like what do you think? And he look at the people who participated in that like Saliyah. The most people who have right to recite. So because of respecting of Sayyida Zainab and because she is the daughter of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Rasulullah, whatever she decided, we respect and we agree, whatever she wants. Then, not only to take Al-As and release him, just for loving Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for respecting Sayyida Zainab, they said everyone even with him. And even all of their money, give it back. So release him, release the people with him, and even give back the money, just for respecting Al-As. Like Sayyidina Muhammad sallam and Sayyidina Zainab. When Al-As went back to Mecca, he gave back the money to everyone, and there is some amana, like some people in Quraysh, they give him some amana, he give it back. He say, now everyone is okay, he say, yes, we are okay. He say, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. In Mecca. Then people said, you were in Medina, right? He said, yes. Then why you wanted to become Muslim? Why you didn't say Shahada there? He said, if I say Shahada there, they will think I am scared. Second, they will think that I wanted to take the money and not give it back to Quraysh. No, I'm not like that person. Akhlaq. He went back to Mecca. He gave back all the money to the people. He gave back amana to the people. And then took Shahada in front of everyone in Mecca. Then he went back to Medina and continued his life with Sayyida Zainab radiallahu anha. So that point happened. When Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went back from Banu Mustalik, that incident about Al-As and these people before even Banu Mustalik. So now after the war happened with Banu Mustalik and Sayyidina Muhammad got married with Sayyida Juwayriya and these things, I forgot to mention the way we are when they are going back to Medina. What happened? What happened is a very huge accident actually. First, one person from Al-Muhajirin, because the army, when the army go back to Medina, the way is very long actually. So when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam want to take rest, some Sahabi want to take water from the well, from Muhajirin. And someone from Ansar came also at the same time. For some reason, Shaitan came, you don't know, Shaitan don't miss any chance. And then they started to talk, they started to have this agreement, they wanted to become, have fighting. Fighting between who? Sahaba. Why? Shaitan. Shaitan is his way, actually. And this is a big reason for Allah for us. Allah is a big reason for us to learn. And because now I'm speaking, I just forgot to tell about the way of going back to Medina. That's why I must correct now, inshallah. So, Banu Mustalik, we're still in Banu Mustalik, about Banu Mustalik. So, the way going back to Medina, it's very long story actually. Yes, I just forgot to tell about this. So, the Muhajir from Muhajirin, he said, Ya la Muhajirin. He called everyone from Muhajirin. And from Ansar, Ya la Ansar. People came. And not only that, some soldiers became like up like this. You are speaking about who? Sahaba. Sahaba. What is the reason? Racism. Racism, Muhajirin, Ansar, group. Racism was a reason to have big fighting among Sahaba. Not us. Not us. I'm nothing. We are nothing one night. We are a very weak people. Sahaba. Racism was a reason and was a big gate of shaitan to penetrate Sahaba. Racism. We are from Muhajirin. We are from Ansar. We are from this, we are from that. When, you know, Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the best human on the earth. He don't get angry fast or easy. It's not easy to see Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi get angry. And if he get angry, he get angry for the sake of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. And when he get happy, we become feel happy. He feel happy for the sake of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. يغضب لله ويفرح لله. صلى الله عليه وسلم. صلى الله عليه وسلم. When Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saw that, he got angry for the sake of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. And he said, دعوها فإنها منتنة. أبي دعوة الجاهلية وأنا بين أظهركم. Racism is jahiliya thinking, not Islam. أبي دعوة الجاهلية وأنا بين أظهركم. Are you are speaking and calling that kind of jahiliya thinking, and I'm still alive among you? دعوها فإنها منتنة. Leave it. Leave it. It's not as a Muslims to have that kind of racism. Muhajirin, Ansar, what kind of that? We are one. So this is a big reason for us as a Muslims here in our society, in everywhere. There's nothing called this American, this Egyptian, this Pakistanian, this from Uzbek, this from Nigeria. No, we are all one. We are all one. Don't give any chance for Shaitan to penetrate us. Even Shaitan wanted to penetrate Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Who's this point? We are from Muhajirin, we are from Ansar. And some souls already became up like this. It will be fights. Among who? Between who? Brothers. Between Sahaba, the best generation ever, the best people after prophets ever. And Shaitan wanted to destroy their brotherhood only by racism. So this is a big lesson for us as a Muslims. We need to learn. We need to be humble. Don't say I'm Japanese, don't say I'm Egyptian, don't say I'm from Africa, I'm American, I'm from Pakistan. No, you are a Muslim only. Don't say I'm from this country, I'm a Muslim only. We are Muslims. We are all brothers, all of us. Nothing say you are higher than this person and he is lower, nothing like that. We are all same, we are all belonging to Islam. This is our nationality, real nationality, we are belonging to Islam. Yes. So Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, alhamdulillah, finished this battle, finished this thing. But munafiqeen never miss the chance. Put it in your mind. And munafiqeen never finish. They were at the time of Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Do you think that they will not be here now? In our time now? In this life now? They are here and many. Many munafiqeen. So munafiqeen at the time of Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who is their leader? Abdullah ibn Abay ibn Salul. The leader of munafiqeen Medina. Leader. And as I mentioned before, munafiqeen are two types. First, kafir type, those who are saying by their tongue that they are Muslim, but inside they are like, they hate Islam, they are not even Muslim. They know this. So this is not Muslims. And that's why Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala says in Quran, إن المنافقين في الدرك الأسفل من النار. Second type, منافق عمل, which means the person who make everything ريا for sure, pray for ريا, speaking for ريا, donating for ريا, everything for ريا. Just like make people say, MashaAllah, MashaAllah, you are a very nice person, MashaAllah, you are a nice mu'min. That kind of like act is also nifaq. But this nifaq and this nifaq is totally different. So the first type, not even Muslims. They are from Ahlul Nahr. Second type is still Muslim. But he just needs tawbah. And he needs to have ikhlas. He needs to fix his name. So Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul, when he heard about what happened between Ansar and Muhajirin, and of course he is from Ansar. He's Munafiq and from Ansar, from Al-Khazraj. And of course, among Ansar are two tribes, Aus and Khazraj. So he said, لَإِنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ In Quran mentioned, يَقُولُونَ لَإِنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلُ. He said, when we go back to Medina, we are the masters, Al-A'az. We will kick out Al-Adhal, the low people. And he meant everyone from Muhajirin, even Safullah Azim Sayyidina Muhammad Sassam himself. Like that. We will kick them out. It's our place. It's our place. We kick them out. We are the people who supported them. We are the people who give them houses, money when they migrate to Medina. We are the people who support them in the war in Battle of Badr and Uhud. We are everything. They are without us, nothing. That kind of mentality we have now also. In Muslim community, unfortunately, we are the people who did. So he said, يقولون لئن رجعنا إلى المدينة السورة لا يخرجنا الأعز منها الأذل. أعوذ بالله. And he said to the masters of Munafiqin, because that meeting in the tent, it was only between Munafiqin. So we call it in Arabic, الطيور على أشكالها تقع. Like the birds who have the same color, they get meeting with each other. Like الطيور على أشكالها تقع. Like, you know some people, we have also hadith. Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, الأرواح جنود مجندة. فما تعارف منها ائتلف وما تنافر منها اختلف. Which means the souls are also like soldiers from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the good soul, good person, his soul become familiar with the other person who is also good, have some like common manners, common targets, common vision. That's why maybe if you will see someone first time in your life and you feel very comfortable for him. You don't even know who, but just you meet him, you feel that feeling. This is the hadith. And some people, maybe he looks like very good, but subhanAllah, just see his face from the first day. You feel that, you know, like your heart is closed and you even can't like have any feeling to even speak with him. Except Salaamu Alaikum Warahmatullah, because he's right as a Muslim. That's why الأرواح جنود مجندة. فما تعرف منها ائتلف وما تنفر منها اختلف. That's the hadith. So Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, زعيم المنافقين, the leader of المنافقين, he sat in that tent and everyone around him was منافق except one person. He was from the same like tribe, but he's not منافق. And he was young. Sayyidina Zayd ibn Arqam. Sayyidina Zayd ibn Arqam, I think in the narration, he was at that time maybe 11 years old, like very young. And he was sitting with them. When he heard what they are speaking and putting a plan against Muslims and against Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and insulting Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, not only Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Sahaba, he mentioned everyone. He said, يقولون لئن رجعنا إلى المدينة ليخرجن الأعز منها الأذل. He means every Muhajirin. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the top of Muhajirin. So he meant him directly. Like that. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. So Sayyidina Zayd ibn Arqam went to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after this meeting. And say, Ya Rasulallah, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. When Sayyidina Umar heard about that, Ya Rasulallah, let me cut his neck. Like, let me make his head fly. You see, come down, Yom, come down. Other people become very angry. Then, Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam put a good plan to make everyone forget about what happened. Because if Sayyidina Umar or any one of Sahaba went to Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul and kill him, it would be a huge fitna among Muslim army and it will be big war. Because Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul was also master, not normal person. He's munafiq, yes, but he has very high rank. So we need to be careful. Like if someone has very high rank, even he's munafiq or whatever, we need to be careful how to deal with him. No matter he's like in the his country very high or whatever, we need to be careful with him. So to kill him is not like easy step like that. So Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to like prevent that kind of like big fitna, it will be big fitna. He gave order to the army, now let's move. But it's this time. say no, now, move. Now, if they move, no one have a chance to speak to each other, just move. So they started to move in a very late time in the night. It's not relaxing time or daytime, no. Very late time in the night. Then first day, they should take rest. He say no rest, only for prayer and eating. No rest. Second day, no rest. Sahaba, Ya Rasulallah, we need no. He wants them to forget what happened. Just forget what happened. Like pass that fitna. In the third day, now they still have one rest to go to Medina. So this last one, and after that they can go to Medina. This is the third day. So the third day, Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha was with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time. And they took rest. And when they took rest, like after walking 3 days, all of them got exhausted. They just want, give me any place I want just to sleep now, just even on the ground. Don't worry, just leave me now. I need some rest. You know, like if you are working 12 hours or 14 hours, and you saw the bed after you finished. See, I miss you. Please come. Like, you know, like that kind of point. All of them slept. All of them. Then Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha, when she went to Qada al-Haja, like toilet, at that time, there is no toilet like us. They go for very far away place in the desert and make Qada al-Haja. She lost her necklace. And then when she went back to the army, she found out that she lost her necklace. So she thought maybe she lost it in the road off, in the way of Qada al-Haja. She walked until that place to search for her necklace. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha at that time was very, like we call it in Hindi, karoy. Not heavy. Very karoy. So for her and for the other like women who are like riding the camels, of course at that time it's not like now. Ghaira, jealousy, jealousy, not like now. Someone walking with his wife and like here without hijab, her chest, everyone can see, mini skirt or whatever, and he's proud. He's proud, he's very funny, like mashallah, my wife is very beautiful. I'm sorry, but he's not a man. Because the real man, Allah Subhanahu created a man, his blood is, you know, blood. He can't afford that. The real man can't afford that even someone see the heel of his wife. He can't. The real man. So the kind of people who walk with his wife outside, and she maybe like almost half naked, he's not a man. I'm sorry, but this is the reality of the real description, to be honest. It's not insulting, You know, pig is big and like, you know, like animal is animal, man is man, right? That kind of attitude is not attitude of man. Maybe you can call it whatever you can, but it's not man. Real man can't accept that. That's why at the time of Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, no one even can see the woman. That's why they make something, they call it al-hawdaj. Al-hawdaj is a something, they put it above the camel. So the woman go inside and no one even can see her during the traveling. Even 1 week, 1 month, can't see her. No one can see her. So Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen. So she is also inside al-hawdaj, that thing. She go inside the carriage and put on the camel. So the time of moving now came, so they must move. And Sahaba who carried the Hawdaj before, they know that Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha, Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha is not heavy, she is very curvy. So she just holds the Hawdaj, al-Hawdaj, and put it on the camel. They couldn't notice or realize that she is not inside, because she is very curvy. Then the army moved to Medina. Because it's only one more stop finish, like next stop in Medina. So Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha found her necklace, but when she came back, no one here. So what happened? he don't know what happened. She said, okay, maybe when they move a little bit, they will ask where is Aisha, radiallahu anha, they will not find me, they will come back to me. He said, no problem, let me sleep a little bit. She put abaya and slept. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of course, like a great leader, not only a prophet, he's a great prophet and a great leader as well. So one of the strategy in the army at that time, when the army is moving, he put someone on the rear. Why? To check if something happened, some people, in sense, daif. Maybe he lost his control or like fall down, or someone lost his weapon or money or whatever. So someone behind the army, after the army go and for some distance, he can check the ground and see if something happened. It would be for state of the army. So Sayyidina Safwan radiallahu anhu was behind the army. That's his mission. So when Sayyidina Safwan radiallahu anhu walked behind the army, he saw Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anhu. When he saw her, he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. He knows that she's not dying, but the situation alone. And of course, alone, it's not by her choice. That's why he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. Then he asked her like to prepare herself to take care for Medina. So she didn't answer him because this is like the akhlaq, no speak, especially if man and woman alone, like she don't speak. So his akhlaq is very high level akhlaq, not normal akhlaq. He brought the camel and he left far away. Why? She's a woman. When she go above the camel, maybe some part of her body maybe will appear, right? And he knows he went very far. This is the akhlaq of the Muslim. Not to pretend to help some lady and look at like this and this. This is not akhlaq. This is sneaky, not akhlaq. So he went very far until he confirmed 100% that she already inside the camel. Then he took the camel and went to Medina. Who is angry from the beginning? Al-Munafiq Abdullah ibn Abi Salul. Very angry. Before the army of the Muslims reached Medina, Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Abi Salul, the son of that Munafiq, is a good Muslim. Very good Muslim. He came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulallah, I heard about what my father did. And all Arabs knows that I'm the most person who treat him with very nice way, Birr al-Walidain. He was famous, that he was one of the most people who give Birr al-Walidain for his father. Although his father is Munafiq, but like his father. So Ya Rasulallah, if you want to kill him, let me kill him because I can't afford to see someone else kill him and I will maybe take revenge and lose my Islam. Let me finish him by myself. I finish my father by myself. He said, no, don't kill him, don't like harm him, it's okay. Even though the love for Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from that Sahabi is more than loving his father, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. More than his father. He was even able and ready to kill his father for sake of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like that, it's, you know, loving Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من نفسه وولده وماله والناس أجمعين. Like this. So when they reached the Medina, the army, they saw someone like in front of the way. So when the army passed, that person are watching everyone. Who is that person? Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Salul, his son. Sayyidina Muhammad sallam went through him, every Sahabi, until he saw his father. He stabbed him and he took his sword and he put it on his neck. Say, Wallahi, you will never enter Medina until Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave you permission. But of course his father got used that like his son is very nice to him and obeying him always. How he's speaking with him like that, you know? But he thought it's not serious. Maybe he's joking or got like some, just like some feeling and it will go back. And then he wanted to move. He took the sword and put it in his stomach. He will, Wallahi, I will finish you now. Now I will finish you. You will never enter Medina until Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give you permission. And that's what happened. He stood like, stand like this, and the sword on him like this, until the order came from Medina. The Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving him permission to enter Medina. But he's still very angry. Why? Even his son loves the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than him. And he's his father. And he would like almost dying because of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's very angry from what happened in front of the wall between Muhajirin and Ansar. He's still putting in his mind. When Sayyidina Safwan came by the camel and Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha above the camel, who saw him? Abdullah ibn Abi Mas'ud. What he said, like our munafiqeen in our life now, Wallahi ma salimat minhu wala salimat minhu. What does that mean? He didn't say directly, look at how the people of Zuz munafiqeen playing with the words. Because they are not, you know, munafiq also one of his like attributes, coward. Munafiq must be coward, can't be brave, coward. So he can't speak directly like openly like this, no. Like, you know, like by Miki Hidari. So he didn't say that he committed zina, but he says some words which can give him the same meaning, and at the same time, no one can punish him because he didn't say that he made zina. That kind of mentality. He said, Wallahi ma salimat minhu wa la salima minha, which means they were alone. And he is young and she is young. I think they maybe did something or not, I don't know. Wallahi ma salimat minhu wa la salimat minhu, like this. But they are alone and they have the chance to do anything. That's such a thing like that. But in Arabic, Wallahi ma salimat minhu wa la salimat minhu. But he didn't say directly that they commit zina. So even if you want to punish him, you can't punish him. Punish him about how? He didn't see directly. So, enter Medina. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha went to the house, her house, and subhanAllah, she felt sick. And she became sick for 20 days. She don't know anything. Then some people started to speak. Munafiqun started to speak and spread the news, and that happened, and that happened, and that happened. And women, you know, women, one woman can just give her one news, the whole city will know. Just one. And then people start to speak. Even the narration says three Sahaba, three, accused Umm al-Mu'minin Aisha radiallahu anha that she already committed zina. You can imagine? You can imagine how big damage the munafiqin can do in our Muslim society? Who fall in that trap? Some Sahaba. Big trap. To accuse who? Umm al-Mu'mineen, Aisha radiallahu anha, that she committed zina. Because of who? Munafiqeen. Why? Because they didn't confirm. They just hear something and believe in it and just speak. Without confirming. That's a big lesson for us. No matter how religious you are, no matter how good you are, no matter how smart you are, whenever you hear something, especially about good people, don't take it easy like this unless you have like 100% like trustworthy resources. You are sure 100% and you like confirmed 100%. Otherwise, no. Because who fall in that trap? Even some Sahaba. Not normal people like us, no. Some Sahaba fall in that trap. Hear something, they believed, spoke. Oh, I heard that person did like one such thing like this and this. Did you confirm? No. And who you are speaking about? You are speaking about Umm al-Mu'minin Aisha radiallahu anha. Not normal person. Not normal woman. Umm al-Mu'minin Aisha radiallahu anha. She's not normal person. So some Sahaba even spoke about that. Unfortunately. So some of them spoke in general, and some of them already said, yes, she committed zina. like that. And Sayyidina Hussein got the news. So you can imagine the hatred of Munafiqeen against Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the leader of the Ummah, the best human, the best creation. Even him took huge damage from Munafiqeen and said very bad words about him, not his house, his honor, his sharaf. No, even normal person like us, maybe he will die from sadness if he hears something like that. You can imagine how big damage Sayyidina Hassan received in his life. Because of who? Munafiqeen. Scholars said, 1 month, the Muslim Ummah stopped everything. No jihad, no da'wah, nothing. Because of this fitna. 1 month, stop. No progress. No progress. Because of what? Munafiqeen. So be careful when you are walking in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that kind of people. Because they will stop you. Whatever you are doing, they will stop you, make you busy. You can't make any progress. Because that happened in the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we need to be careful. We need to learn from Sirah and implement in our life here. To learn. We need to learn. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard about that, he spoke on the member that some people said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And of course, some Sahaba know who is the source of that fitna, who is the source of that information, fake information. They know that it is Abdullah ibn Abi Salam. They know. So the leader of Al-Aws stand up and said, Ya Rasulullah, if he is one of us, we will take care of them now. We will finish them now. And if they are from Al-Khazraj, they deserve to cut their, like, their head. Sayyidina Sa'd, when he heard that, he's the leader of Al-Khazraj. You see, what do you mean, and what like this, and fighting. When Sayyidina Hassan saw like that, he felt like he went down from the member and left all that things. So even the fitna of Munafiqeen giving like huge damage for Sayyidina Hassan and for Sahaba themselves had big disagreement. Instead of discussing about Dawah or about how to protect Medina or how like this and this, no. Only busy in some internal problems. That's what happened in everywhere now, unfortunately. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Sayyidina Zayd and Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib in special Mashwara. Mashwara is good in every time. So he asked, like, what do you think? So Sayyidina Usama and Sayyidina Ali, Usama ibn Zayd. He told him, Ya Rasulullah, it's just fake things and no one even can believe such things like that, and please don't even care about that. Because it's no one even can believe such things like that. Sayyidina Ali said, Ya Rasulullah, women are a lot. Like, if such damage came to your side by Sayyidina Aisha, you can divorce her and can get married with another woman. Then Sayyidina Aisha, 20 days, she don't know anything about that. Anything. Everyone speak outside, and she is inside her house, she don't know anything. But she realized that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam changed. Before he was like, you know, she is his beloved wife. He loved her so much. And he, even when she become sick, he tried to let her feel like good feeling and speak with her very nice way and a very romantic way and these things. So she was sick, but he just say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How is she? Like, kaifa halu hayatik? Not even, how are you? No. How about her? Like something like that. Not even direct word. So she realized that he's changed too much, but she don't know what is going on. Then she asked his permission, Ya Rasulullah, I'm very sick, and can you give me permission to go in the house of my parents to they can take care of me? He said, okay, you can go. She went there, then after one day, she wanted to make qada al-haja outside. She went outside, and one woman went with her. She also for like toilet, qada al-haja. Then that woman fell in her face. When she fell in her face, she made dua against her son. Said Aisha, said, why you are making dua against your son, and he is one of the warriors of Badr. And the warrior of Badr, Battle of Badr, all of them are going to Jannah. This is hadith. So Rahman Sassam said, everyone who participated in Badr of Badr are going to Jannah. So you are speaking to someone who is from Ahl Jannah. How you are making dua against him like that? He said, you don't know what he said about you? See, I don't know anything. Then that woman told her, he said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and what's that? Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha, when she heard about that, she went to make Qada al-Hajj, right? From her sadness, she didn't even have ability to do that. She went back without making Qada al-Hajj, without making toilet. From her sadness, she got shook. She didn't even believe. Maybe this is the biggest shock in her life. Of course, after the death of Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this is maybe the second biggest shock in her life, to hear that people are speaking about her sharaf, her honor, like that. And who? In Medina. Speak about Sahaba. She went back and she started to cry too much in the house and not speaking to anyone. One of the best situations, and this is my advice to everyone, Allah, learn from Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu and his wife. Learn from them. The best situation ever happened from Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu and his wife. What is that situation? Other people are speaking, right? Just heard one news, speak. Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, no. He heard about that. Wallah, that's why I say logic is very important. To use our mind is very important. He asked his wife, he said, do you think that if I were in that situation, you will believe that I will do that? She said, Wallahi, no. You will never do something like that. I know your akhlaq. And he said, and I also never believe that you will do such thing like that if you were in the situation of Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha. He said, yes, of course I never betray you. It's on my dead body if I can do something like that. Then he said, then Safwan radiallahu anhu is better than me, and the Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anhu is better than like maybe 100,000 women like you. That kind of point. Of course he didn't say like 100, but like ta'bir, you know? That point. Like Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anhu is totally different level. So they cut this point at all. They say it's impossible to happen. Why? Because you are speaking about very high and very religious people. It's not even imaginable to do that. So when you hear something about someone who everyone knows that he's a good person, don't just believe it like that. Confirm. Take your time. Why? The people who are working in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always getting demonized. You need example? We are here. You are Hanafi. He is Hanafi. You are Hanafi, right? Your Imam. Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu. What happened to him? How he died? What happened to him? That great Imam. What happened to him? They demonized his reputation. Demonized his reputation at all, and he died in the prison. Who? Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. I'm speaking about little boy like me. I'm speaking about Imam Abu Hanifa. He died where? Did where? In the prison, because he destroyed his reputation. Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, radiallahu anhu. Imam Bukhari, Sahih Bukhari. You know what happened to him? Wallahi, that subject need what khutbah? Wallahi, that subject need one khutbah. One full khutbah about it. What happened to Imam Bukhari? What happened to Imam Al-Shafi'i? What happened to Imam Ahmad? What happened to Imam Malik? What happened to Imam Abu Hanifa? Wallahi, need khutbah. How they died? What happened to them? It need khutbah. The greatest imams in the Islamic history. What happened to them? It need khutbah. So we need to learn. It's a big lesson for us. Who is speaking about someone very high level, very rich person, and say he did like this and this and this, or she did like this and this. Confirm. Use your logic a little bit. And put yourself in his situation or her situation. You see, if I were in his situation or her situation, I would do that. Then think about the other person. So that we call it in Quran and in Islam, hadithat al-ifk. Al-ifk means the most extreme lie. This we call it al-ifk, the incidence of al-ifk. So who is the resource of that hadith of al-ifk? Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul al-Munafiq. Spoke about who? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best creation ever. And who? His wife. His wife, Umm al-Mu'mineen, radiallahu anha. The daughter of who? Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, the best human after the prophets. And unfortunately, some people believe that. Some people believe that. That's why when I got shocked, when I read the biography of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, or Imam Malik, or Imam Shafi'i, what happened to him, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, and how many years he spent in the prison, and they whip him like day by day and say, Quran makhluk, Quran makhluk, Quran makhluk. Yes? And Imam Bukhari himself, how he died. Wallahi, this khutbah. Imam Bukhari himself need khutbah. How he died. What happened to him? Then, you know, I got shocked and I didn't believe how Muslims fall in that level. Then, when I hear that subject about hadith al-ifk, I say, yes, now it makes sense. Now it makes sense. It's not only about the greatest imams in the history of Islam, it happened in the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and again Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his wife. So we need to learn from our history. We need to learn from Sirah. I'm not coming here to just speak about some stories. No. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ. The last verse in Surah Yusuf. Last verse in Surah Yusuf. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. عِبْرَة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us listen. It's عِبْرَة. To learn from what happened before. Why? To not repeat the same mistakes. So this is my advice to everyone. We are learning Sirah to understand Islam very well. One of the most things which helping you, Sirah. But to read Sirah and learn Sirah from every point of view, not only from the story. Because we have something we call fiqh Sirah. And analyzation of the Sirah itself. And the story itself. And the situation of every Sahabi. And how Sayyidina Hussain dealt with this, this position and this position and this situation and this situation. And what happened in this battle and this battle and this battle. Not about war, what happened in that rules, ever, advices, situations. That's what we need, inshallah. That's why I'm focusing on Sirah to teach everyone about that. Not speaking only from the story side, even from every other point of view, inshallah. Inshallah, finish now because the azan, inshallah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لكم وقول صلى الله عليه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. جزاكم الله خيرا.